Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us for AmpFest so far. My name is Naina Raisinghani, and I'm a product manager on the AMP project. So far, everything you've heard is about what the next year holds for the AMP team. However, we also wanted to take the time to shed some light on what the upcoming years hold for the team as well. Now, users are still frustrated with the web because the experiences that they have on the web is incredibly poor. When they click on a page, the page loads slowly. And when content appears on the screen, it's not interactive. And when it is interactive, it might get displaced by other units on the page that are still loading. And this is why the Chrome team launched a new initiative called Web Vitals. It means to allow developers to focus on the performance metrics that matter and have a path to creating a high-performing page for their users. It's made up of metrics such as largest contentful paint that measures loading, first input delay that measures interactivity, and cumulative layout shift that measures visual stability. Now you can learn more about these metrics on web.dev/vitals. The Google search team has also announced that it will build upon Core Web Vitals to measure how the page is experienced by a user in addition to prior signals such as a page's usefulness. This suite of measurements is called Page Experience. Page Experience will also use other pre-existing signals such as mobile friendliness, safe browsing, HTTPS security, and detection for intrusive interstitials. It's a great way for performance advocates to have targeted metrics to consider when thinking about the experience that their users are having. Now, AMP lines up pretty well with the goals of Core Web Vitals and Page Experience as well. In fact, it is our goal that AMP be the most cost-effective and simple solution for publishers who are trying to create a great page experience. And to hear more about this, you can listen to Ben Morse's talk on Page Experience and AMP. With the Page Experience announcement, there has been a shift in the way that Google is now measuring the experience that users get when they're landing on a page instead of requiring a specific format to assure great user experience. As of today, when teams are thinking about their web investment, they have one of three options. First, a custom setup that uses your framework of choice and allows the team to hyper-optimize every part of the site's performance. The benefit here is that this is something that your team is already comfortable with, and it is the least constrictive in terms of how you want to monetize, analyze, target users, etc. However, you still have to meet the criteria that is set out by Page Experience. And the challenge here is that you have to invest in specific teams whose responsibility it is to monitor, maintain, and then correct a site's performance and make sure that it lines up with what users expect. Now, you could also invest in AMP by either investing in paired AMP, which a lot of publishers do. Here, AMP acts as your performance team, your QA team, your infrastructure team, and it does it all for free. Now, we do our best to make sure that your sites are performant in the long run. But the drawback here is something that you've already experienced. There are monetization constraints as well. And this is by design to make sure that we're able to create performant sites that offer great user experience. However, the largest problem with investing in paired AMP is that you're signing up to maintaining two code bases in the long run. You can address this by investing in AMP first. You can use AMP as your library of choice to create great web experiences. And this builds on top of paired AMP, but doesn't have the ongoing dual codebase maintenance cost. This is all well and good, right? But what does building a site with AMP actually look like today? Both paired AMP and AMP first have their own opportunity costs. Paired AMP has the ongoing maintenance costs I mentioned, and AMP first may not be capable enough in some cases. And even when a developer does pick one of these, the path to creating a valid and cached AMP page is not as simple as starting and then writing some code and having a valid page that is cached. There are multiple roadblocks on the path to creating a valid and cached AMP page. You may want to do something that AMP doesn't have a component for. You have to stitch sessions from cache to origin to ensure that there's proper attribution when moving from one to the other. Then there's that pesky Google-branded URL from any Google navigations. It's also hard to optimize your pages, and it's difficult to do A/B testing on AMP pages. This is a long-winded way of saying that developers find that AMP's added overhead actually outweighs its benefits. which is why we want to invest in allowing developers more flexibility in how they create AMP experiences. A large problem that site owners have with AMP is that users perceive their content as being tied to Google due to the google.com/site URLs when they're navigating from Google. However, in April 2019, we launched AMP signed exchanges, which allow you to retain your own owned and operated content while still benefiting from being loaded incredibly fast. You can do this using AMP Packager, and you can learn more about it at go.amp.dev/amp-packager. Now, another problem that we've heard from developers is that while AMP caches do add speed, they add development complexity as well. And in some cases, businesses might want to opt out of being served from an AMP cache for any business-specific reason. And in that case, we're currently working on a path where developers can opt out of being served from AMP caches, much like Google or Bing's. Now, I would caveat this by saying that in this case, we encourage developers to think about signing up for a CDN to still get the performance benefits of being cached. Now, there's another common misnomer, which is that when a business is thinking about investing in AMP, they're having to give up their preferred CMS or their preferred framework. However, it's quite the opposite. Like any other framework or library, you have to put an initial investment into integrating AMP into your current development workflow. Most frameworks and CMSs like Next.js, 11t, or WordPress have actually developed great first-party integration with AMP, and this makes everything that much easier. Now, while other frameworks don't have that same fidelity, this is something we're definitely looking into, so do reach out to us. And if you want to learn more about the AMP plugin for WordPress, you can watch Alberto's talk about it later. Now, the biggest concern that publishers have is that AMP's performance constraints doesn't allow them to monetize as aggressively. And reasonably so. How to invest in the web is often a conversation between revenue teams and web development teams. And this is why in April 2019, we announced that we're kickstarting a project called Bento AMP, a project that allows you to take AMP components and use them in otherwise non-AMP pages. This means that instead of having the traditional notion of a valid AMP page, you can now invest in AMP as you see fit. Your technical team could experiment with a few AMP components and test how that performs and how users respond. They can then slowly ramp up their investment to be a largely AMP page, where there are a few non-AMP components such as monetization or personalization. Or you could think that AMP is a great fit for you and invest in making your site perfectly valid AMP. Bento AMP provides a gradual upgrade path to a fully valid use of AMP. And if you don't want a fully valid AMP page, that's okay too. You can stop where you feel you have reached your goals. Now, I'm sure that you're all dying to hear about how the Bento AMP project has been going so far. And I know that Dima has some updates to share in that area as well.
Thanks, Naina. Hi, everyone. My name is Dima. I'm a software engineer at Google. I've been an AMP contributor since the project's beginning. And now I'm a member of the AMP Technical Steering Committee. Here is how we prioritized our work on Bento. AMP has been historically fairly static. So first, we are making all AMP web components fully mutable. This means that changing an attribute or a child in DOM will always be correctly reflected. This would enable AMP web components to be used with other frameworks right away using standard DOM APIs. Second, we are re-architecting AMP runtime to work correctly on non-valid AMP pages. This mainly involves removing some of the initial assumptions of a page's structure and optimizing for mutability. Third, we will enable AMP web components to operate without AMP runtime at all. And finally, we are also planning to publish AMP web components to be used in React and Preact apps. And here is where we are at this time. We designed and built the architecture to turn Preact components into web components and to integrate them with AMP. This technology maps DOM structures of a web component to an embedded Preact component that implements all UI and logic. This architecture is mutable by design. Further, our UI team has used this bridge to rebuild several AMP elements. We started with a simpler but diverse set of AMP elements, and since then we moved to more sophisticated composable components. we added modern tools such as Storybook to demonstrate and test both preact and web components. And we have been steadily reducing dependencies between AMP elements and the AMP runtime. Let's take a look at what's next on our roadmap. First, we will migrate more components to Benta. As the framework matures, we will start migrating more aggressively. Second, once we have a more complete set of supported components, we will launch the initial library of Benta web components that work on pages with AMP runtime included, whether or not those pages are valid AMP pages. Next, we will enable Benta web components to run without AMP runtime. Finally, we will publish React and PR component libraries for independent use once we are confident in our public API surface and distribution strategies. Thank you, and back to you, Naina.
Thanks for sharing an update there, Dima. Now, based on all of the information we've shared with you, what does adopting AMP actually look like? Now, you can start off by testing AMP out by using a few AMP components. And then if AMP first excites you, you can actually invest in making sure that all your third-party JavaScript is only in AMP script, and this gets you to a valid AMP page. And if you want your AMP page to be cached as well, great, you can do so. And if not, just make sure that you're still giving your users a great page experience by using the CDN as well as an AMP optimizer. And that's roughly it, our roadmap for 2021 and beyond. We want to invest in a more flexible AMP approach that gets you the best of both worlds, page experience optimization and development slash business flexibility. And this means that your technical and your revenue organizations don't have to pick one over the other. And with that, thank you for joining me to learn more about how we're focusing on making AMP the easiest way for developers to create and then maintain high quality web experiences. Let us know if you have any questions. I'm NanaR92 on Twitter if you want to chat. And with that, I hope you enjoyed all the content that the AMP project has put together for you. Thank you and stay safe.